Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Talking Screen. I'm your host, John, better known as Dave, around the X-Men, and we have a fantastic show for you. White Mantle gets social, the Tournament of Legends is around the corner, and get ready to hoard because ArenaNet is looking to store. Woof. And so much more. But first, let me introduce you to my fellow host. He is a moderator over at MMO Champion. I really wanted to see him dressed as Deadpool. Did anyone else want to see him as Deadpool too? Say hello to Jim. You're muted.
It's 12 out of 10. That was beautiful.
Or he's doing it on purpose.
Yeah, I'm doing it on purpose.
Boo. See what I did there, though? Deadpool 2? Yeah. And he writes over on his blog, agegaming.wordpress.com, where he answers the age-old question, if the White Mantle has more followers through social media than I do, who is real and who is the fake? Say hello to Age.
I have no idea, actually, but greetings, everyone.
Awesome. So, if you don't know, I'm going as legendary armor. See, look, I'm going into battle.
No hands.
Bravo.
Oh, that was great. Now we can't get off.
All right. We'll see how long this stays on my head.
Transfer it back.
Yes. Might be. It's a slow process. Still being worked on. That's why it's not ready yet. Okay, let us jump right into it. So, this past week, it's been more of a slow news week, but some interesting stuff did happen. Apparently on Facebook, the White Mantle have been, posting, and also the Shining Blade has been responding, which is pretty interesting. The White Mantle post in question actually reads, and we have it kind of here, both of them. The White Mantle say, I think we all know the feeling of supporting someone, putting your best efforts into helping them succeed, going above and beyond to move mountains, or at least very large stones, for them. Only to get burned when it turns out you don't know them like you thought you did, and then like and share if you ever felt unappreciated and betrayed. Well, in the comments, the Shining Blade actually had a little response to that and says, yes, we imagine it's very upsetting to have to reap what you've sown. So, yeah. What does all that mean?
A hashtag shake my head.
I just, kind of interesting that they're having, you know, various organizations be active on Facebook like this.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. I don't know how meta they're going to get with this.
Oh, the Reddit posts of people, like, saying, like, how it's, if it was Codicus posting on it, and it just weirdly beautiful. But, yeah, it's kind of interesting because we have talked in the past, and I know a lot of people have started talking about this as well when this came up. Was with the store, we kind of do have a possibly two different White Mantle going into the future stories. Ones that are behind Codicus and ones that are behind Lazarus. So, you know, a lot of people are wondering, is this maybe Codicus speaking to the White Mantle that he wants to, you know, try to keep with him and maybe feel betrayed by, you know, the Mersot and Lazarus?
I don't know. Does Lazarus have Facebook?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, he's been kind of dead for a while, so probably not. I mean, he's got to kind of catch up on everything else. I mean, it's been, what, 250 years?
Would it say, like, in a relationship with White Mantle, and then it's, like, just says it's complicated underneath?
Well, I mean, you got to figure. I mean, you all remember, you remember how long it took Steve Rogers to get a handle on things. And, I mean, he only had, what, like, 80 years? Lazarus has a lot longer to catch up on things. I don't even think he's gotten to the internet yet.
Very true.
Deo, go into battle. Go fight the Hounds of Balthazar.
Oh, great. Now it's going to take a while to get off. Talk amongst yourselves.
All right. But, yeah, it's just kind of interesting. Hopefully this is like a tease at what's to come, because I think we even said that, and I know a lot of people said it once it kind of, the story, where it left off. And do you think we're going to see like a civil war, and maybe where, like, yeah, where's the Shining Blade going to fall in all of this?
The whole setup that we've got here with a possible friendly White Mantle faction, I mean, it's just, it's weird. I mean, even, like I've said before, I didn't play much of Guild Wars 1, so I'm not as up on the White Rod, the White Mantle lore.
Were you gonna say the White Rogers?
I blame Kate, because I was reading the line she just typed, so. Anyway, the White Mantle, I don't have as much of a mental image of them as everybody else who's from, like, Guild Wars 1 has, so it's just kind of this shadowy organization that just kind of suddenly shows up, and half of it is loyal to Codicus, and the other half is loyal to Lazarus, both people who I know are kind of historically dicks.
Yeah.
Though it's getting to a point where it's like Lazarus and the Mersat as a whole were kind of historically dicks because they were trying to not die.
Yeah.
So.
Well, it is kind of interesting. They always said that about in Guild Wars 2, that the unique thing about humans is they are now the race that's like on the way out. Like, usually that was like in other fantasy games, like always the elves or, you know, some other race, like humans were always the dominant one, whereas in Guild Wars 2, they're kind of the diminishing group, which maybe, you know, there's that kind of, going off what you're saying, kind of that similarity there where, you know, everybody always thought the Asurin, because like Ratasum spelled out, you know, was an anagram Mersat. Maybe the humans are the next Mersat.
Well, historically, humans are usually the super desperate ones to maintain any kind of stability in most sci-fi fantasy, so maybe?
It kind of fits with the Mersat. I mean, they kind of did, were like, you know, all the races were planning stuff the last time the dragons are rising, and they were like, we figured our own thing. Bye, good luck. It's like, wait, what? So, but luckily, you know, with Glenn and all that stuff, that we were able to, the other races were able to hide, but yeah, so it's kind of interesting there's that parallel there. But yeah, I've seen a lot of people suggest like maybe, you know, Civil War type thing, which that could definitely be interesting, and I hope they definitely utilize the unique dialogues that they were playing with in like season 2 and stuff, where maybe if you're a Char or something, like it's like what are the other races going to, you know, play a part in, like, you know, if it's a civil war, it's like, are some of the races going to be like, that's just between you guys, like, that's
just
not
just
our thing.
Popcorn and watch, man. Like, it's War Creator Part 2.
Well, it's like, you have that, but you also, it's like, it's a civil war, but it's like, if we kind of let the White Mantle win, they were kind of doing an evil thing of bringing back, like, something that was destroying things 250 years ago. So it's like, who do you interfere and you don't interfere, but then maybe interfere later? So it's definitely going to be interesting.
Who knows?
It's true.
And I mean, talking about just doing this in general, do you guys want to see them do more stuff like this? Like use Facebook, Twitter? We've seen in the past they actually did that with like their loading screen with like Evan Nashblade taking a dig at Ellen Keel, and still to this day.
I don't know. I wonder about that because it's kind of not really related to what's going on in the game world. So that's the one thing that I worry about, is that it's like this is Facebook, not not everything else. So it's kind of, it's like share, and if you know you've had this happen to you, and it's like there's no Facebook interior. So it's kind of one of those like suspension of the immersion going on. So I kind of like it, and I'm kind of like
my immersion.
I'm not necessarily the kind of person that it's like my immersion, but it's one of those things where it's like it can be kind of corny if they force it too much.
Mm-hmm.
So unless it's just the little like digs and jabs every so often. So.
And like Chad's saying, yeah, it's a hype builder, not too much to be taken serious. Yeah, I'm not gonna ever see this as like this is now canonical to, you know, Tyria. It's like, and through through the mist, something called Facebook appeared, and the White Mantle used it. Like,
called Mistbook.
Mistbook. Oh my god!
That was the true purpose of the Revenants. But hopefully this is a tease, and maybe we'll next week or in the couple weeks at least have a tease of maybe the next chapter, which possibly could be a civil war. Hopefully a civil war with Divinity's Reach. Chat's ain't face scroll. Yeah.
I would not mind seeing another city invaded, not necessarily destroyed, but like. I'd be totally cool with the whole, you know, even hub cities are not safe. I like that. I like that as a concept.
Mm-hmm.
Divinity's Reach, I would say, then, because it's most relevant.
Yeah.
That would be interesting, yeah, and maybe even work in some of, like, Codicus Manor stuff, like, since, you know, it is Codicus leading, unless he totally ditched his manor, even more so. But yeah, we shall see, and hopefully we shall see soon. But also this week, we got a forum post by Lindsay Murdoch basically asking what would we want to see in the material storage. Now, she laid it right out there. It was like do not ask for certain things, like. And some of the stuff were no crafted components, so like when you're creating a sword or something, like the hilt or something, none of that. No keys, sorry Jim. And no pure salvageables. She felt that if you're able to salvage it, you know, you shouldn't be able to store it in the material storage. Which, for people that don't know what a material storage is. If you've been playing for a while, oh my god, this is going to blow your mind. We have a little gear. You can send raw materials to a storage thing that by default holds a stack of 250 items. You can increase that in the gem store, whatnot. But basically it has an assortment to help alleviate some of your bank issues. But if you're a hoarder like me, you're still going to buy the bank tabs.
My issue with basically the entire setup of that post was, hey, what do you guys think of material storage? By the way, you're not getting any of this. And I believe one of the lines in there is, the sky is the limit, except for these things. And I'm just like, then you don't say the sky's the limit, because you literally just put a limit on it that wasn't the sky. And honestly, they're talking about putting, you know, blood rubies and petrified wood and chalk eggs and all of those things into the material storage. I know that, Red Wolf, they might already be working on those things, but, like, that's one of the things is, like, with the key ring, they've basically already communicated, oh, you're not getting a key ring. Like, I don't know who said that, but that was like a month or so ago that they basically...
Yeah, it wasn't during one of their AMAs or something. Like, someone brought it up and they were just...
And it's just one of those things where it's like petrified wood and bloodstone rubies and all of those other map currencies, they already have a place they can go. The currencies tab.
Like, yeah, I agree.
The thing and is, then, for unbound energy.
You know what you do with that? You take away the salvage requirement and you just double-click them. Because you can do that with pristine fractal relics in the wallet.
Oh, you can?
Pretty sure. Because that was that was the mechanic on the pristine fractal relics in before they became
a currency. I thought
there
was a vendor for it.
Or there might be a vendor for it.
There's a vendor for it, but...
Yeah, you might
either way, that's what they could do to make it so they could just put it in the currency. You know, just...
But it's one of those things where if it is a currency, it should be in the wallet. If it is... I get parts of the whole thing where it's like crafting materials, like piles of salt and pepper, the blade hilts, and all that other stuff. Generally speaking, when you craft one of them, you're just going to take that and move it to the next step.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the only reason you'd ever have just a bunch of Elderwood staves in your bag is because you're crafting a legendary.
Yeah, or one of the Mystic Forge recipes that were quite, like, one of those rare... Yeah.
Like, but generally speaking, when you're crafting it, you're crafting the number that you need. You're not keeping them in bulk. Unless you have a really weird idea of what it is to keep storage. But anything that drops from the world that immediately has... That is literally dropping just for crafting purposes should have a storage tab in the material storage. Just flat out should be there. So
yeah. I mean, we've talked about this loads of times in the past. Yeah, I totally agree that, you know, it's surprising that we still have, I'm pretty sure, things from launch and, you know, from the core game that are definitely crafting materials that aren't in there. It's just... But.
Okay, Baron's saying that you just have to go to the vendor. You can't double-click on the pristine relics. So,
and potentially a search feature, because sometimes that gets a little nuts to go through there. I'd like that for that. But.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I would like petrified wood, and well, I'm trying not to trigger myself, but I'll go into a huge rant, and then, you know, people get mad and stuff. So, they already said blade shards are going in, which is good. I would honestly like petrified wood, and bloodstone rubies. I was thinking about this for a while. I think it just makes sense to put them in there because, one, you could just, if you want to store them to use for later, you have that slot. And then if you want to, like, use them for unbound energy, you just take some out and use it. So it just kind of makes sense in that respect. You don't have any problem there. Other things that kind of like things that sit in your bank that you can accumulate over time, I think, should be put into the bank, into the material storage, like with the exception of crafting components and food and things like that. That's what I would like.
Honestly, I think they said lesser vision crystals are going in. I want to see...
Well, no, some people suggested it, but did they actually confirm that? Because they asked, like, both types of vision crystals, because...
I'm pretty sure vision crystals are confirmed. Okay. I'd have to find the Reddit link, but... because somebody actually had a post where they've compiled everything that people have asked, and then they're editing it, and they're doing bold for things that are confirmed to go in, and they're doing strikethroughs for things that are confirmed to not go in.
Oh.
So...
But...
I just, lesser vision crystals needed to go in. Blade shards are definitely going in. That is the only thing truly confirmed right now. Black Lion salvage kits are not going in.
Things that make sense, right?
Well, actually, one of the people in the actual official thread asked that it would be really cool if we could get a crafting or a Mystic Forge recipe to combine Black Lion kits to make 250 use like Mystic kits, but you know, Black Lion quality. Nice. But it would cost like several Black Lion kits that were unused, so you could merge them together. So
then you just get like, then you just get keys, and then you consume that. But yeah,
Writs. Let's see here. Writs and Tomes of Experience are out. Boosters are out. Sigils and Runes are out.
Yeah.
They
don't belong. Yeah.
No, they're not crafting materials. They're armor enhancements. I mean, some crafting materials can be used as armor enhancements, but
I mean, yeah, even I have a ton of those, but I agree that shouldn't be in material storage.
Right.
Yeah. Oh no, I agree with that. Are there any things that you didn't see there that you want in there? Or?
I mean, it's kind of hard to look much. I honestly, I can't.
The issue I have is more that there are so many other items that need some kind of storage mechanic. Like Eternal Tonics need some kind of like shrinking mechanic, so to speak. Like you need maybe a polymorph or a poly-use potion or something where you could like slot your Eternals into it, and then you can just like double click and then you can choose which one you turn into. A toy box of some kind for all of the toy items, because I mean, I saw responses in that thread that doubloons haven't been confirmed, Bayorn, but I was gonna say
that was one of the things I was thinking of, because that's that weird middle ground of it's
armor upgrade or crafting material. Yeah.
Yeah, but it is used as like a gem, like the other ones that have a slot. So it's like, mm-hmm. So yeah, I definitely agree that I think doubloons should be in there.
But the that's one of the things is people are like, I need something to store all of these Black Lion or these gem store things, because I'm not buying stuff off of the gem store anymore because I don't have any room for it. So it's one of those things where without some kind of toy box, ArenaNet's actually losing out on money.
Mm.
I don't know if it's a large amount of money, but they're losing out on money.
I wouldn't mind to see if there was a purchasable upgrades like that to do that. Just like basically it's a specialized like bank tab type thing that can be accessed anywhere. That way, I mean, for them, it's technically like kind of double dipping on these, you know, same item, but that is a legitimate concern. Like people are like, I want to, you know, get more stuff, but I'm running out of room.
Bayorn, I'm with you for the tonics and the toys as like a wardrobe item. And yes, he is the Prince of Pop. But the issue I have with gathering tool skins is because it's more the items themselves that is the issue. Instead of like you're trying to like the pick, like I have the Watchwork Mining pick. Deo, contain yourself. But it's one of those things where it's like that mining pick is an individual item, and now he's stuck. Success.
I'm part legendary armor and part man in the iron mask. Anyway.
But with the eternal harvesting tools, it's just one of those things where it's like, I don't know if that really fits in a wardrobe style thing. Just because it's not like you are just slotting an appearance, the actual item itself has physical properties. So
yeah. I don't know how many toys people have or anything. Well, actually I do have a lot on my thief, but I would like to get
more if they would make more bundles that were unique, but anyway, yeah. That's not part of that, but
it's a lot of toys or a lot of things you could buy from like the Super Adventure Box, Boombox, things like that. I don't know if that's, would that be considered part of the wardrobe thing or no?
I mean, it's definitely, I think, categorized as a toy. Yeah.
It's technically a toy, but yeah. So I don't know. Because in the end, like, they do want to sell bank tabs, so you have to put stuff in there.
Well, that's why they have to find that line.
The line, I guess, is...
Yeah.
Well, the only problem there is that there already is a line. You can only buy so many bank tabs.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think in that case, you don't even, like, you know, people are, you know, saying options for tonics, toys, you know, gathering tools, stuff like that. If they would decide to go this way, they don't have to roll all that out once. Like, maybe, you know, after this year, they do the toy box to alleviate some of that space. Because, like you're saying, people are running out of space to buy this stuff. So you want to maybe slowly free up those spots. Kind of like what they did with the dungeon tokens. People filled their banks with those, and then, you know, that quickly got taken out. But it's like, you know, if they came out with a toy box that, you know, maybe remove or opens up 20 slots, just say. So maybe that will, they're like, okay, that'll, you know, keep us happy and still potentially sell bank tabs to people that don't have them all for another year. And then we do the tonic wardrobe or...
They promise us a toy box for the next expansion. Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
That is going to be interesting if they're going to... I am curious to see what they're going to announce for the expansion, like feature-wise, since this past expansion was the feature-heavy one, and now it's supposed to be more content-oriented, which MMOs really don't tend to do that. I mean, you look at, wow, they always have features to throw out there to entice people. It's like, you're just promising people story, but, you know, before we digress too far. But...
Bark, bark, bark.
Yeah.
I don't know. And then there was one other comment that kind of stood out to me, and I think it was actually from the Delphi page on this. The fact that Lindsay Murdoch said, I am categorically refusing to add crafting components. There are far too many for me to go through and do that on an item-by-item basis. Well, there's an issue there, because... cooking, and like, as I talked before, is like, you know, parts of a sword, axe, whatever, there's not really that much from armor or weaponsmithing stuff. Cooking and scribing generate so many materials that don't have storage, but you need bulk of them on hand. So it's one of those things where it feels like some of the cooking and scribing stuff, there's the like rare lumber cores and strange ore chunks for scribing that just kind of, you just get them as rare drops out of harvesting nodes. Like, pigment goes in, the wood cores and all the other stuff, they don't have a storage slot. I've gotten feathers off of a moa that was a crafting material for scribing but didn't have a material storage.
And I was gonna say, I haven't done cooking in a while, but I remember that's what kind of turned me away from scribing at launch, was it was very much like, you know, the hot dog and hot dog bun issue, where it's like, you would be able to make like 10 items in one go, but it's like, oh, you only need 8 to make it. So I still have like 2 in there, and I can't put it away. Like, it's like, well, thanks. Like, am I just deleting this?
For people who don't know the adage, hot dogs come in packages of 8, hot dog buns come in packages of 10.
Yeah.
So.
Wait, not ours.
America.
Yeah. But with cooking, I can't. I haven't done scrambling.
Speaking of cooking.
I will not. Well, speaking of cooking. And I'll just say on scribing, I don't know, because I don't do scribing, because I probably will never touch it until it's relevant for me, I guess. But with cooking, I know I kind of learned that I should not make crafting components unless I'm willing to use them 100%, because it just takes up space. And if I do have extra, I'll usually just sell it or put on another character. Because, yeah, I kind of learned that the hard way, but... Yeah. I feel like with cooking, it's kind of negligible. With scrapping, I wouldn't know, because I haven't done it. So,
well, on the bright side, a lot of the stuff for cooking and scribing can be sold on the trading post for a decent profit, because people don't want to deal with the shit that you're dealing with right now. Like, they just want to buy what they need. But it's one of those things where it's like, you are basically consigning yourself to dealing with runoff that you need to throw at the trading post in order to clear your inventory. And I don't want to call it loss, but you're turning materials into unwanted goods. Sure, it's turning back into money, but there's a conversion rate there that you're probably losing out instead of just selling the raw materials.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And yeah, like what Chat's saying, like, you know, it'd be nice if scribing, like, you could put like stuff into like a guild hall storage for the other guildies. See, that still goes back to such a, like, I think scribing was, I think we talked about this at launch, like, never was a fan of scribing of how it was implemented, because it's a, it's meant for the guild, but it's personal. Like, well, it's a honestly, personal leveling up, but it's meant for, to be done together as a guild.
Well, at the very least, I can say thank you to Red Wolf for restoring Timmy, if you guys have been in the guild hall near the inn lately. So, we've got our very own lion statue. I need to fix that up. We'll rotate that around and get our own old lion's arch fountain floating around if we can. Maybe, literally maybe, floating. Maybe it won't get blown up, so.
And never say never. I'm in the guild, so, you know. But
I agree. Like, scribing is in a very strange place where it doesn't have much in the way of personal benefit, so unless you really have a guild that really enjoys doing stuff with decorations, it's not an amazingly compelling system to level with, especially
unless you're trying
with
to get the legendary Flameseeker prophecies through the. Doesn't that still require the book or something?
From scribing? I think that's a relatively low thing for scribing, isn't it?
Oh yeah, I think they did change it to lower. So
I don't know, but I still like. I kind of agree that it's kind of odd that. It's that weird personal progression for group use thing.
Yeah, and yeah, that I totally agree with you, Bjorn. And I do like the idea of scribing. It's just that weird thing of they even say it where it's like you're supposed to level this up as a guild. Well, then why not attach it to the guild? Like, that'd be interesting if guilds had crafting disciplines. I mean, it's kind of like expanding, it's making your guild more meaningful. Because my one worry, and like I said, I haven't seen it happen in Guild Wars 2, but this is my mentality coming from other games where it's like, you know, I've seen it like in raiding and other games and, you know, any kind of progression or putting effort into something. I could just hear the horror stories of like, oh, we helped this one guy, you know, get to max, you know, max scribing, and then like, oh, see you, bye guys, thanks for, you know, all the, you know, max scribing, and I can go anywhere with it, whereas if it's attached to the guild, it's a lot harder for them to run off with it, unless they're like the guild leader and just kick everybody. But that's always my, you know, concern in the back of my mind from other games. So, yeah, I'd like to see like a retooling of scribing, but because it's definitely a cool concept. I mean, I think you're muted, Age.
Sorry. Right, I was typing.
He was raging. Come on.
Yeah, sure.
Get into your anger.
I was going to say that it's hard to make scrapping a guild thing now because of the way it is, but I think the next crafting thing should be, that's related to Guild Hall, should be a guild-wide thing. It should require like help from everyone in the guild. You don't, you know, and one person or anyone really could just craft the things necessary to upgrade the crafting of the guild itself.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's it promotes working together as a guild towards a common goal, and hopefully, like, the goal of getting to max crafting would get you good stuff to make. That's kind of the end goal of that. So if there's, like, a big shiny thing that everyone wants, it's like, okay, let's work towards this together as a guild, you know?
Yeah, I mean, they love putting backpacks in the crafting disciplines. Now, imagine if, as a guild, you leveled up scribing for the guild all the way to max level, and then, like, maybe to celebrate, you all have the, you know, printer press backpack, and you guys are running through Divinity's Reach celebrating, like, we just, like, as a guild, because everyone could make it, not just, okay, we got Jim to max. Hey, could you make that... Or wait, I don't even know if you could make that backpack for everybody. Like, it's bind on yeah. pickup. So, yeah. It's like, okay, thanks. Like, it definitely shows that, like, you're working together towards that goal. And, you know, it's just basically a crafting discipline. But if it was that way, I could definitely see their reasoning by making it such high cost that it was at launch. If you were all working to it as a guild, which... I mean, people were, but it's also like, we're working as a guild for Jim to get it to max level. I would like it to be max level. Yeah, but that's a whole lot more flax. Like, it's not realistic, whereas, yeah, I'd definitely like to see guild crafting disciplines.
Also, don't tie scribing to personal goals. Like, Flameseeker Prophecies, you need scribing to get a book. I think you need 200 scribing for it. I can't remember, but don't tie it to stuff like that. That's just irritating, because if you don't know who a scribe, you'd have to, like, find one and all that stuff, which I actually gladly knew a few, but like, you shouldn't need scribing, which is a guild-centric thing, for a personal goal like a legendary, you know?
Yeah, it just goes back to that weird... It is a group thing, but it's also a solo thing. It's like...
This is like Trigger Age Day, but you won't get me. No.
Oh, come on, Age. Give in to your anger.
No.
Here, I'll take the brunt of it. Hey, raiding sucks in Guild Wars 2. All right, they're mad at me. Go for it.
Raiding's actually pretty good in Guild Wars 2. Except for...
I didn't mean go for it as defended. I meant... I was trying to pull aggro.
Except for the bugs. Bugs that never get fixed. I still think Zera has a few bugs left with it. But I digress.
Yeah, digress off of the rating thing that was supposed to pull aggro. And get on to your anger about the missing storage.
There's a new portal, by the way. I didn't put that in notes, but there is a portal. I don't know if you talked about it last week, because I wasn't here last week.
We did, briefly.
Okay.
Unless they added another one, which...
No, it was a fourth wing. And I know that Shaman made, like, a funny thing, and it linked to Pelota, and that was awesome. I hope that's true, but...
Yeah, good luck with that.
I love
Elota, I would like it to be, but that's... If anybody else has any thoughts on the material storage, and if you're watching this on YouTube, definitely throw it in the comments of what you guys would like to see. We did see a couple in chat, and maybe in your ideas of scribing, or maybe even future crafting disciplines, and if they should be guild centric or, you know, player centric. But let us move on to the Tournament of Legends. The Tournament of Legends 4 is coming November 5th at 11 a.m. Pacific / 2 p.m. Eastern. That's for NA. And the casters for that are Storm and Hurix. And for the EU, you guys will be playing on November 6th at 7 a.m. Pacific, 3 p.m. GMT, and 4 p.m. CET. Casters for that will be Jebro and Helseth. So they do mention that signups close an hour before the event starts, and there are still spots open. So if you want a shot, I think we were talking about this before. Isn't like the grand prize like a legendary of your choice or something like that?
Yeah, pretty much. I think it's an original too.
So hey, if you don't have scribing and you want to get that shield, win the tournament champions, you can pick it.
No, I'm not falling for that. And they are streaming it on the Guild Wars 2 channel if you just want to watch the games. So,
oh, awesome.
I think it's the top 8 that they're going to stream. So,
like, it's literally open to everybody. So, are we actually going to see like people that have or the teams that ran the championships? Because that would be a bit insane. I'm assuming not Helseth's team. Just if he's casting, that'd be he'd be like, oh yeah, I'm poning this guy right now. It's pretty great. Like, so I'm guessing not his group, or at least he's excluded.
It's like anyone can join. Okay. So it could be like a mix of teams. Like it could be like TCG and Rank 55, like a mix of them if they want to do it. It could be legit first come first serve. I know that, I think it was, I'm trying to remember, I think it was a mix of, I remember Helseth tweeting about it earlier, but maybe he was joking, but, should be fun to watch, and you could see people that you've never seen before. You could see people who play at the Academy Gaming weekly, that make teams and things like that, or should be good times. And mm-hmm. I kind of watched the EU games for Jebra and Helseth casting together. That'd be just amazing.
Yeah, it's definitely gonna be a interesting mix, just the casters themselves.
So yeah.
Definitely look forward to that. And like I said, remember it's NA is November 5th, and EU is November 6th. So. Definitely check those out or participate if you want to.
If you want to help out, you can message Storm about it. I don't know what you could do. I might actually try to help out. I don't know what I could do, but could be fun.
And we'll have like the links for like the post and like the sign-ups and stuff in the YouTube description. So if you're watching on YouTube and you're interested in that, definitely check out the description for all the links to all this stuff. But any final thoughts on the Tournament of Legends?
I kind of feel like I'm behind the time on this one because I'm just like kind of meh on competitive PvP. I know I've been playing PvP more, but it's just kind of one of those things where I found that it's kind of difficult for me to even watch PvP in general for any game. Just over the course of the years, I don't know why.
Mm. To watch SKT versus Rox Tigers. That series was insane. But trust me, just go back to the VOD and watch it. You'll like it.
Eh.
I know you're shrugging now, but trust me. Continue.
Okay. I would say, I think Rocksteady, isn't that a guy in Turtles?
No. League of Legends, sorry.
ROX Tigers is the name of one of the teams.
Yeah.
Oh. Speaking of turtling, you can do that in World v. World. I had nothing. But, yeah, they just posted their relinking for World v. World. It was literally yesterday. North America, you are... Thank you, chat, for supporting me on that. North America, Blackgate, Jade Quarry, and Tarnished Coast are all by themselves again. Maguma and Eridon Terrace are a team. Yaxpen and Anvil Rock are a team. Fort Aspelwood and Sanctum Rawl are another. Sea of Sorrows, Emery Bay are another. Stormbluff Isle and Gate of Madness are another team. Dragonbrand, Borless Pass, and Koenig are another team. Northern, Shaver Peaks, and Sorrow's Furnace. Wow. This is crushing my head slowly, and the dogs aren't helping. Hengeden, Ravi, Ferguson's Crossing, Isle Janthir. Does someone want to continue with the list? I'll be here.
And there's Crystal Desert, Darkhaven, Devonis Dress for the last group up for North America. For Europe, we have Far Shaver Peaks, Pekin Square by themselves. Seafarer's Rest and Whiteside Ridge are a team. Desolation, Vabi are a team. Gendera, Runes of Samaria are a team. Auroglade, Black Tide, Fissure of Woe are a group. Gunner's Hold, Ring of Fire, and Underworld are a team. Riverside, Alone Reach, and Kodash are by themselves. Drakkar's Lake, Miller Sound are a team. Abaddon's Mouth and Dasnar are a team. And Jade Sea and Fort Rannoch are a team. Vizuna Square, Arborstone, Arcree Rock are a team, and Baruch Bay are by themselves.
Kate, what server are you on? And is it, like, is getting matched up against Blackgate that big of a deal?
It's when you're, I think it's because of the Glicko rating adjustment to the Yaxpen that put them into Tier 1 this week, or was it last week? I don't remember what we're matched up against this week.
Oh, FA. Okay. I honestly am not sure. Like, I don't.
Yeah.
I'm not a huge, like, that's one of the things where, like, I look at WDub sometimes and I'm like, this doesn't make much sense, like, with the way they have stuff matched, and then it feels like there's no real progression. So, I don't know.
This is why I'm saying we need a tournament. We need a tournament to spark general interest in World versus World, and, you know, everyone gets Chinese, and it promotes people to come in and play. We need that. Like, I don't know how far, I need to go back and check on the list of, like, the bucket list of World versus World changes to do. I think we're pretty close, though. But we need something. World versus World, because, no, I like roaming around having fun, but, you know, I kind of want an objective to go for right now. I mean, the reward tracks are in itself are something to go for, but I feel like it's just something casually I go for rather than something like, I really want this.
Right. Deal.
So that's why I'd like a tournament or something.
Yeah.
Or Legendary Back Piece would be nice too, but I don't know how they do that.
Carnifex, like you talk about the PvE players wanting shinies. My hero's Mistforged Dagger, Mace, and Shield.
Feels bad.
I may be one of those PvE players looking for shinies, but I mean, at the very least, I'm not just kind of rolling around in WDub just like goofing off. I know what I'm supposed to do.
Yeah.
And I don't do anything like terribly crazy. It's like I follow a commander tag, and I try to keep myself alive. I try to help keep other people alive. But I agree, like a WDub tournament would be a fantastic idea, because it would definitely spark interest in everything again.
Yeah, because I know hardcore World versus World players don't want PvE players in the game because, you know, it kind of ruins the Zerg and all that stuff. But, like, come on, man. Like, getting more people interested in the game mode itself is really good. So, and sparking interest is always a good thing. So I would just like to see that, even if, you know, sometimes they don't follow the commander, at least you're going to have some people follow the commander. It's not the worst thing in the world, in my
opinion. They're fodder distractions.
Yeah. Just use them to your advantage. That's what I use Zergs to my advantage, so when they're doing something, I'm getting something else. Good times.
So did you get any loot off the Hounds of Balthazar?
Nah, yep. No one still. Nah, no one still.
Two blues and a green.
Two blues and a green and some Imperial fragments.
But, yeah, I came back and was here in a tournament. Yeah, I agree. I would love a tournament. I mean,
right.
And I agree with chat. Oh. That's when the Axe Bend becomes good. We need our PvE players want shinies.
Yeah, and that was where I did the whole thing where I pointed at myself, Deo. Cause,
nice.
Because I've got the dagger, the mace, and the shield from the Heroes Misforged stuff, so.
Yeah, I think I have a couple of the pieces. Yeah, they set it up so they could have multiple, and they kind of know they kind of said that they were waiting till all the stuff, like all the dust cleared for War of the World, and that kind of became a bigger task than I think what they were expecting it to be. So I don't know. It just seems like they really got to do something for morale. But any other thoughts on War of the World and the ranking stackings and?
Right. Accurate.
Well, okay. I will shout out this person who played like an outnumbered staff Daredevil. It's somewhere on Reddit. I gotta find it again. Yeah, I tweeted it out, but definitely check it out if you're looking for that. That's pretty sweet. I might go back to staff now.
Have some fun. Nice. Let us take a look at the gem store. So, we got some new gem store stuff. And first up, and always thank you to Dolphy. Check out dolphy.net to check out all the gem store stuff so you can spend your gems more wisely. First up, we have the Ghostly Outfit, 700 gems. Interestingly enough, there was a bug when it first released on Tuesday where if you previewed it or if someone was wearing it near you, I believe, it actually crashed your game and people were actually using it in like World v World and like situations like that. And
apparently only if you had your graphics set to low.
Yeah, that's one thing that they discovered.
Oh,
so.
Oh, because maybe it was because of the helmet?
Yeah, I think they said it was due to the helmet's effects on it. And so, like, honestly, it was like the elite PC Master Race bug. It's like, you run on low settings? Puh. Well, this is going to affect you. So. But, oh, good.
I kind of really want the outfit. There's two reasons. One is because, Diablo Paladin look. Okay. And two, if anyone has seen Trinity Blood the anime, it kind of reminds me of the outfits that the priest wore. So, that's pretty awesome. So, those are my reasons.
In general, it actually does look pretty awesome because Tavik and Chevron they were wearing it during the first match we were playing in Zero to Hero this past week when we tried the Guardian jump scare comp, and none of us know how to play Guardian in PvP and it went horrifically bad. But the outfit itself, even on low settings, looks pretty good.
Mm-hmm. And if you're noticing the pictures there, some like smoke around the feet, Dolphy also put out a video where you can actually see it actually has foot effects, which you'll be able to see in the...
Does it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like the grasping...
It's like shadowy hands.
Yeah. So...
Oh, wow.
I'm wondering, what are your guys' thoughts on this? I know this kind of created a little bit of an outrage just because... reserved for legendaries, but
I would. Okay, well, people need to calm down about that. It's yeah, pretty much. It's not like a footfall. It's more like a aura, in my opinion. And I feel like you could actually go for 800 gems if you really wanted to. Like, it would suck, but like I could see them bumping it in that case. But I'm kind of glad they didn't.
Yeah.
But it's
definitely think 700 gems.
It has like
a good
an aura.
Price.
It doesn't really have footfalls, it looks like.
I don't
know.
Really
it's constantly
see a
there. So oh, go
it's,
ahead.
It's an outfit.
It's more like aura or outfit with an aura, in my opinion. It's pretty cool.
But I do want to talk to you guys. I'd love to hear chat's opinions also, because this did get brought up also with the bug and everything. The bug that was discovered on Tuesday when it launched about it crashing, a lot of people were saying, like, why was it, why was it still a thing? Because people did notice that it was having this crashing effect previously to the Tuesday prior, just because of data mining and the chat link that was provided through it. So they were wondering why wasn't this kind of like caught or at least looked at a week prior? Because some of the responses from ArenaNet employees were just kind of like, we like the wording on it's kind of awkward just because they say they don't engage in, like, you know, data mining, you know, videos, forum posts, or, you know, leaks, which it's like, I don't know. I understand don't engage in the sense of talk to, but if it is the possibility to catch a bug a week early, I mean, wouldn't you want to catch that? I mean, what are your guys' thoughts?
My only thought on the issue is that, like, people were saying they were finding the bug when the item was in-game but not available. So, you know, like, we get a lot of items where you could get the item code in and you can view it, but it's not officially released yet. If it's not officially released yet, then they have not said that it's... It, basically, them releasing it is them saying, we think this is ready to be released. So there could be bugs with issues. There could be bugs or a whole bunch of other stuff with items that aren't officially released yet. So it's possible that they thought they had this fixed when they released it, and it just hadn't been fixed.
And so, I think one person actually did say that. I didn't see any ArenaNet staff actually say it in the forum posts, and, you know, they don't have, you know, they don't really have to because it is, you know, prior, you know, of that patch. But someone did say that supposedly they did fix the chat, like the datamined version, but I guess when they updated it might have rebroke. Once again, I don't know. You know, it was stated. I did not see it from an ArenaNet dev. Maybe they saw it somewhere else, but, you know, that is definitely a possibility. I mean, stranger things have happened. So, but, you know, it is...
That and,
oh, go ahead.
Well, that and, like, it's always possible for stuff to make it to, like, testing or even to live that shouldn't. It happens a lot with a lot of games and a lot of code. Just not even just with games, it happens with programming in general, is something gets left in and people forget to comment it out or remove it or what have you. So it's possible that the fix was there initially and then the broken version got through instead.
Yeah. I mean, like, I think about it this way. If this wasn't data mined at all and they just put it in, would you think the same way? I mean, it was a bug that happened. And it's unfortunate. They pulled it back, they fixed it, and they put it back out. So that would be the good part of it. Whereas if you see that as data mined, and you see that they didn't put it out the next week with all the Halloween stuff, and then you realize, oh, it may have been broken, and then they put out the next concurrent week, and then they say, oh, it was broken, and they still haven't fixed it. That's the mentality people are going for. So this is kind of why I don't pay attention to data mine stuff. I, you know, when things come out, they come out, and, you know, I'll accept it as they are. So I feel like ArenaNet did, maybe they didn't put out the week before because it was broken. They tried fixing it. They thought it was fixed. It's like, okay, it's good to go. They pivoted it out. It eventually was not fixed. They realized that. They fixed it, and it's all good now. So we have an awesome outfit. And all is right with the world, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, whether or how you feel on it, it is fixed. They did take it off the store for, I think it was a couple hours. I know it wasn't any more than a day, but it might have been
it
just
was
like
8 hours.
Yeah, it wasn't even that long. So it's up there, 700 gems. Remember, it is an outfit. So as you can see here, you can hide the helmet, which is, you know, the black smoky part. I do like how it has, like, the strands that, you know, are part of, like, the shoulder piece, but it goes over the head, you know? So,
yeah.
You still have part of the outfit on the head, even without the head showing type of thing. So, I definitely like that aspect. But, yeah, 700 gems for that. It is leaving Tuesday, so if you do want it, pick it up soon.
Damn it.
Yeah, it's leaving with Halloween.
Do this.
As Age buys that apparently right now. Another item is the Hovering Mad Mirror Travel Toy, which we were talking about travel, you know, toys before with like Toy Box and stuff. This is a travel toy. It's 250 gems. If you have like the magical broomstick, the magic carpet, the electromagnetic descender, I believe it is, or maybe it's the ascender. One of the two. That's the toy version. It kind of works the same, where this is basically almost a cosmetic mount, where it kind of, you can activate it as a toy. You can hit a button where then you can kind of go into combat mode, you know, fight. And as soon as you leave combat, it puts you back on this item. But just think of it as a cosmetic mount. You don't go any faster. There's really no, like, skills attached to it type of thing besides going into a combat mode to, you know, engage a fight. But it is definitely, you know, you can see here how it's a Halloween-themed mirror. You can see, like, the Mad King moon, you know, kind of the green, creepy sky of Halloween. So what are your guys' thoughts on the hovering Mad Mirror travel toy?
I think it's cool. This is another thing that kind of needs one of, like, its own dedicated hotkey. Like, it would be nice to be able to slot one of these mount toys and just be able to hit a button on your keyboard instead of having to go into your inventory, double-click something, and then go from there. But
ooh, it should be actual, like, a travel toy key, and then you in your hero panel, it would be like you can equip.
Yep.
That'd be really nice, actually. Yeah.
Yeah, I would not mind that. But you can see it has the same mounting visual as the magic carpet for each of the races. But yeah, I mean, and I see how some people in chat, you know, they had the carpet, so they're probably passing on this. If I had a choice between, well, it is tough. I am probably going to pass on this year, mainly because what we talked about before of, like, running out of space. Just money-wise, I'm probably going to go after the outfit before the, you know, travel mirror, just because I also have the carpet. But yeah, I definitely like the look of it. I like how there's, like, chains streaming off of it. I mean, it's definitely a pretty looking, you know, item, but it's just, I think there's so many inventory management problems for a hoarder like me, which I don't know if I'm a special case or from what I've seen in chat, you know, there's a couple people that have that, you know, issue as well. And hopefully they've figure out a way to make it so we have more room to buy stuff. But any final thoughts on the hovering Mad Mirror?
It looks cool.
Yeah. Another new thing is the Bloodstone Glider. So for 500 gems, you can now glide. And this is just a glider, not a back piece. So don't think it's like the other things where it's a back piece glider combo. It's solely a glider. It is not dieable. That's important to note. But yeah, it just works like every other glider. Once you buy it, you can equip it in your hero panel, and when you're gliding, that will be your new skin. So what do you guys think for 500 gems?
It's a glider. I mean, it looks good. It's one of those things where it's like, it's a glider, it's 500 gems. If you like it, grab it. If you don't, don't.
Yeah. It kind of sucks it's not dieable, but I understand why, because they wanted to stick with the Bloodstone theme, I guess.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, because
I kind of wish that...
Oh, God.
I kind of wish that, like, some of their more atypical gliders, the ones that just work, like, via magic, not actual aerodynamics, would, or potential aerodynamics for the case of some of them, but
like the bubble, like, glider.
Well, that's magic, clearly. But like this one, I kind of wish they wouldn't go so hard for the actual wing shape, so that like it kind of conforms to a standard wing shape. But it's pretty clear that, you know, the Bloodstone Glider is not gliding because it's aerodynamic. So I just feel like they have a lot more leeway with things that aren't supposed to look like they're physically gliding to with art styles. So I just feel like they could do more with atypical designs for the glider wings instead of just like making them wing shaped.
Kind of like if it was like shards of bloodstone that were keeping you afloat or something like that.
Yeah.
Not necessarily in a wing shape, but.
Right, or if they shifted differently as you like did the different lean techniques and everything. So.
Yeah.
Or like kind of like rolled around each other for like the animations, but.
Yeah, I can definitely see what you mean, and yeah, I'd like to see them get a little more creative with the gliders. I mean, they have in the past, but yeah, it really seems like they're sticking to the wings theme for a lot of them.
I can also definitely agree with Kate. It'd be really cool to see like the flying carpet as a glider.
Yeah,
and some of the like the broomstick as a glider.
Oh, that'd be amazing.
So.
We might, you know, that would be pretty cool if some of the toy items would transfer as a glider, since they are trying to be more mount-like. So maybe in the future, who knows? That would only make it more enticing for a player to buy it. So if it's a coding issue, hopefully they, you know, maybe one day, you know, figure out how to do it. But last up, which was, I don't know if they were messing with everybody, because once again, data mining kind of got everybody excited. People noticed that there was a mini feline familiar that you could get, and people were like, oh, it wasn't there last week. It's definitely going to be here this week. Well, it didn't show up on Tuesday. People were like, what is, no, why? It was there, which that's important about data mining. You take the risk, it might not be implemented. But luckily, I think it did show up it was either Thursday or Friday.
Mm-hmm.
But the mini feline familiar, it is 350 gems, and it's just, you know, standard mini pet. It unlocks for your whole account with the, you know, more recent mini update, you know, where basically it saves it in like a wardrobe type thing. You can pull it out anywhere. So, for 350 gems, would you guys be picking up a mini feline familiar?
No. I generally just don't buy minis. So, it's nothing against minis in particular. It's just like, I'm just not interested in minis unless it's like from a Black Lion chest.
Does not roll 0 of 10, would not buy.
It stretches. Aww.
Is it like the whole cat thing? Like when you pick up a cat, it looks like it becomes like 10 feet longer. Like when it's stretched like that, it looks like it's longer than it's taller than a certain if you stood it up.
Well, long cat is long, so. But unless they actually bring Polymok into this, I'm not terribly interested in it.
There's like this sludge, damn it. I want it.
That's one of the things I've never really gravitated towards as a cosmetic thing, just because as much as I like, you know, the cosmetic mounts that we're kind of getting, it's that you're still having to go into an inventory or a window to activate it a lot of times. So it's still the same way for the miniatures, because half the time they don't show up, so you have to like toggle the checkbox. So it's not flawless.
That and one of the stranger things, like that's the minis are the first thing to get culled during high player density areas. So you're talking about a cosmetic option that is quite literally considered the first thing to go in order to keep your gameplay smooth. So why bother if it's going to be one of the first things to disappear?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying that, like, it doesn't have some kind of mechanical effect in the game, get rid of it. Because, I mean, if that was the case, then we wouldn't have all of the armor and weapon skins that we have. We wouldn't have these cosmetic toys. We wouldn't have all these gliders. Mm-hmm. It's just quite literally mini pets have just the sole use of looking good. Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, and that is a good point that it's like you are paying for a cosmetic that potentially won't be seen just due to you're going to a place where there's a lot of people.
Honestly, I think even if you drop your performance settings way down, it just automatically removes mini pets.
Yeah.
Like, if you have really low graphics settings, you don't see mini pets anyway.
Mm. Yeah, so. Yeah, and I'm right there with Chad. Like, yeah, it just seems like it's too much of a hassle, like, each time to go into there. And so, I mean, you know, if you are a fan of minis, like, I know a lot of people were, you know, eagerly awaiting this. It's just, I think it's one of, once again, us three aren't really searching for minis like, you know, like that. If we get them through Black Line Chess or like vendors, like I'll usually pick them up at the hard vendors, like that just came out with the last story chapter, so I picked those up. But yeah, I'm not gonna, you know, spend gems for a mini personally. Let us look at some returning items. So you got here on the left the Batwings glider combo, which is 700 gems, and the devil horns on the right, which are 200 gems. And important to note, the Batwing combo, that is also a back skin and a glider, unlike the one we showed earlier, the Bloodstone glider. So you will get a, you know, back slot skin, which, so you can run around with Batwings the whole time. Would you guys be picking in any of those up, or have you already, since these have our previous Halloween items?
I actually have the Devil Horns already. Batwings, I don't have a character I can use it on.
The Batwings look good.
Although I would like to be Asura Batman, if I could make that
man
look.
Bat. Be amazing. Asura Man-Bat?
Yeah, I actually had both, because I think the Devil Horns originally, like the first year, were the free head slot, or no, maybe they weren't. I think they were just an outfit or a town clothes. But
Bayorn, you're talking about the Lunatic Guard outfit. That's actually the greatest thing about the Lunatic Guard outfit is you can dye the flames, and we actually had people in a raid group previously that would, on Veil Guardian, change the die slot for the flames, so they had a reminder of what split to go to.
Yeah.
So.
Which is definitely a clever way to do it. Okay, yeah, Chad's saying the Devil Horns were one of the free ones, so I thought so, but I wasn't 100% sure. It's been a while. But yeah, definitely pick those up if you are, you know, interested in them. I have both. Like I said, I got the horns for free, I guess, at like near the launch. Bought the bat wings. Definitely, you know, used them for a while, but yeah, I like when it has a back piece and glider combo because it transitions very well usually. The permanent Mad King finisher, you can see it here. Basically, it's an everlasting one. I know if you've been farming Labyrinth, you probably got hundreds upon hundreds of temporary ones, you know, one time use and then it counts down. This one is if you want it 24/7, no matter what, for 500 gems. Would you guys be picking that up for 500 gems? And if anybody in chat.
I haven't run out of the Mad King finishers that I have from last year, not to mention the ones that I got from this year, so I kind of already have the permanent Mad King finisher, technically.
Yeah.
I don't use a target, like I use the randomized finisher, because I figure I'd rather just do that instead of just, like, I know Age has the Super Adventure Box finisher, so it's the pixelated mushroom cloud, and you know, you really like that, I know that much, so you have that one selected, and that's the only one you use, but I like all of the ones that I have, so I'd rather see all of them. So, I mean, I still have Winter's Day ones from last year that I'm still running through because of that, but, I mean, if you do the Labyrinth enough, you don't have to buy it, Side note, for anybody still trying to do the meta for Halloween, you get credit for the using Mad King and Scarecrow stomps for just starting the stomp.
Not really?
Necessarily. Yes. You don't actually have to complete.
Are you serious?
Yep.
I could have gotten so many in Morbus World this week. Damn it.
You don't have to finish the stomp. Though I think you only get credit for once on a person. It's not like you can start stop it constantly.
That's fine. But that's like 10 finishes I could have gotten for free.
It's really not that hard to get. Like, you just go PvP for a bit one day between now and Tuesday.
Oh, Chad's saying you can apparently also do it in the Guild Hall Arena. I didn't even think of that, so.
You have to complete. Oh, and you can. Well, hell then, Age. We can go into the arena and you can kill me over and over again. It's just like when Deo would. It's just like when Deo would jump off of cliffs for us for Daily Reviver.
I don't know what you're talking about. Is that bannable offense?
Hardly.
What's the limitation when I can start talking about it? What's that in internet time? But anyway, I kind of agree with you. I probably have, if I could track it, I probably have, one-time use Mad King finishers probably from the first year. Like, you usually get so many, but yeah, if you are a fan of it and that's what you're solely using, then yeah, definitely pick it up. I mean, but other than that, yeah, if you've been farming the Labyrinth or just been doing it any other year, you probably have more than enough to tide you over. But
reminds me, Colosseum achievement should be ending next week, I think. I think they said November 3rd will be the end of it, so if you want those, better hop on that.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Definitely get those before they go away.
I don't want to be up until 6 in the morning.
I need to win 15 more matches.
Well, then you do it tonight. So you don't have. You're up till 6 a.m. tonight, and then you get to sleep.
Yeah, right. Like, that'd be good for me.
Speaking of good for you, Jim, where can you be found?
I can be found on Twitter at MalthanusMMO, and I can be found here on twitch.tv/TalkingScrit every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time for Zero to Hero, our PvP night.
And Age, where can you be found?
You can find me on Twitch, Twitter, and YouTube at Age Night Road. I'm not usually dressed like this, but yeah. Stream.
But you're going to start?
I'm going to. No. Uh-huh. I stream Guild Wars 2 and Overwatch a lot. I didn't get a chance to stream Gwent this week, but I might do that a bit. Should be fun.
Awesome. And you can find me at simply_dare, where I probably won't be wearing this helmet because it is hurting my head. Watch that throughout the whole episode where I'm struggling with this thing. If you are tuning at the very end, and we do an after show, so definitely do stick around for that if you're watching live. But we do throw this up on YouTube. Just search Talking Scrit on YouTube. We're usually the first one that pops up. That will go up on YouTube on Sundays at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific. And if you're watching on YouTube, if you can make it out on Saturdays, we do pre-show and a little bit in an after show. But definitely stick around. Definitely come out for that if you just want to chat in a less serious note. But that we go live every 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific on Saturdays. So hopefully see everybody next week. And as always, we will see you in the game. Good night, everybody.